Spuddy Webb, Midland, Texas. It's Valentine's Day, 2017. What I want to talk today about is something I don't get into a lot, which is possible motives for murder. One of the reasons that I stay away from the speculation things is because I don't have the proof on it, and you know, until we identify and arrest the secret police, or you know, and find out who they are and get handcuffs on them and charge them with crimes, and it's like, why did you do this, you know? And then we really don't know, you know. So that leaves me with speculating, and then when I speculate, people go, "You said this." Well, I'm like, "Hey, my guess is as good as anybody. It's probably better than most because I know what's going on here." But what I want to lay out, I want to talk specifically about possible motives for murder. See, what I told people, I said it many times, is the what question. Okay, the what happened question. It is pretty well known. We don't know everything, but. Because of the police reports, because of the security camera pictures, because of the medical reports, because of recorded audio, and other pieces of ballistic evidence and hard evidence, we got a good idea of what happened. Okay, I mean, we know that for sure. We know information on the previous homeowner. It looks like he was murdered here in 2008. I come in, first call the police was in 2010 for a burglary. They put on the police report 1096, which means crazy. Here I'm a 25-year company man, you know, never had a felony, and all of a sudden I have somebody inside my house. I figure that out. I call the police, and I'm called 1096 right off the bat. Okay, and it's a couple months later, then I figured out somebody's in my attic. You know, now that's really strange. I understand that. It's not common, but it's happening. And I've now documented half a dozen more people that I've recorded off the scanner of it happening in this area. I've had people from around here, more people that write me and tell me about it. People even today telling me about it in other towns around here, in Alabama and California and Oregon and Colorado. I've got people all over the country telling me similar stories of what's going on here. I think it's a human trafficking ring. That's all on the what's going on. First call to the police for somebody in my attic, January 2011. Okay, we know all that. Reported to the El Paso and Midland DEA a suspected smuggling tunnel, not to Mexico, over to 50 foot to the secluded trucking lane behind my home, where I seen all the suspicious trucker traffic, and where two store employees told me prostitution was going on. I seen a little girl sleeping cabin 18 wheeler. You know, I suspected there was a little short tunnel between there and my house, and it was connected to this human trafficking. Okay, anyway, I called the DEA. And come from a company cell phone. I recently gave that phone number to the Texas Attorney General. I also gave that phone number to the Department of Justice and to the U.S. Inspector General so they could verify this, check it. Somebody in the DEA they never looked. They never come. And, you know, and my best guess is they were planning on me being dead, because 2 weeks later I'm shot by surprise in my home from the ground. Okay. Now, you know, if I just said that, it's one thing. But when I show you the pictures and go, yeah, here's the entrance wound, here's the exit wound, 2 inches above the ground, and I show you, here's the size of pellets that were removed from my foot, and here's the size of pellets were in my gun, and look in this room here, and you can tell there's not enough physical room for me to be shot, and look at the evidence report, and you'll see that there's no empty shotgun shell, because I wasn't shot with my own gun. And more than that, then we got this gang of what I call secret police, that I believe are corrupt police, that got caught sneaking in my home to cover up this unique murder attempt. Okay, that's all the what if. Okay, I don't want to get off too far off subject. Let's get back to why. You know, why they murdered the previous guy and then they tried to murder you. You know, and what's the deal? Well, I mean, it's still speculation. So now that's just possible motives. Okay, one of the things here is I got married for a short time in 2011. This woman, she's the first one that says, oh, you think they're coming from the ground? And that's where I thought, you know, I finally figured out, yeah, they are coming from the ground. At first, I'm going, nah, ain't no way. But, you know, I'm like, yeah, I'm positive about that now. She's absolutely right. I believe she knew about it. And so we separated, 3-month marriage, the month before I was shot. And she took my life insurance booklets from my home that I didn't know about. And then she brought them back the week before I shot. And that's when I found out they're gone. And my sister-in-law, Mitzi Webb over in Hobbs, she told me, yeah, I seen them while they's gone. They's only gone like 3 weeks from my house. My life insurance booklets, okay? One of them's my accidental death booklet benefit, and that added about $500,000 if I died by accident, okay? And remember, this is just possible motives. I'm just laying out the facts. This happened. Verifiable facts. Go check, you know, the sister-in-law, whatever. The life insurance booklets were taken. Filed divorce 5 days before I shot. That's a fact, you know, and I'm not even naming names, okay? And then about 8 months after I'm shot, then a guy gets a hold of me that I didn't know, contact me on Facebook, and sends me a, I've got this posted in my Facebook, sends me a, we have a Facebook private conversation. I'll turn that around there. Hopefully you can see it. And do you think so-and-so had anything to do with the shooting? I dated her for a short time here in Lubbock, and she threatened to have me killed. Okay, this is Arthur Welch, and talking to me on October 5th, 2012. And I said, you know, I feel pretty sure that she wasn't here, but she would have gotten the house and about $500,000 if I would have died by accident. Remember the accidental death booklets? Okay. And her brother-in-law happened to be the ER doctor of the hospital tonight when questionable things happened up there. But, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He writes back and says, well, I think she had a lot to do with it from the things she said, and I'm so never will trust her again, okay? And then I went on, and, you know, did she mention any names, et cetera, okay? But two things I want to point out. She threatened to have him killed, you know. This document was entered in court, and it was verified that was the boyfriend, okay? And then come to find out that the detective that closed my case was her childhood friend. They went to elementary and junior high school together. And I believe that same detective that I write about all the time, which is named Detective Rosie Rodriguez, is one of the secret police I was talking about that got caught sneaking into my home just a few hours after I shot. Because and it's documented at the hospital where I'm telling the nurse, there's proof at my house, there's proof at my house. And Rosie was in the room. And then what we see, that somebody tried to disable the security camera inside my home. And a few minutes later, we start seeing the pictures of the secret police that nobody will identify. And one of them is Rosie. I mean, that's all there is to it. So what happened is she found out evidence was at my house because I told her. I was at the emergency room going, proof was at my house. And so they come sneaking to my home and accidentally got caught on camera stealing the proof, okay? And that all comes back to, because she's the childhood friend of the person that was going to make almost $1 million and get the house if I died from a three-month marriage. There's your possibility number one, okay? Possible motives for murder, you know? I mean, I'm not saying that's what happened. I'm saying, you know, here's what Arthur Welch said. You know, and here's her childhood friend that I believe is one of the secret police. We're still waiting to get that verified. I believe that we'll see that. And another thing that happened, we had just separated. So, and I was having my, remember these break-ins started in 2010, and then they're getting in my attic, and us together, we tear gassed the attic during 2011. But I did it again after she left, and I tear gassed them one night, and I got them good, and I knew I got them. I mean, because this ain't a little bump, you know. I mean, you know, I've seen a person in my attic. I've heard them fart, snore, cough, giggle, you know, drop their gun or whatever, you know. Plenty of, just so much evidence. I have the X recorded in 2011 of trying to extort money, admitting on tape to trying to extort money over me, admitting on tape to being here while these crimes were going on, and then trying to extort over $1,000 a month from me. Remember that? That's the childhood friend of the detective that closed my case and called it an accident and then called me crazy. Okay, remember that. But anyway, so I tear gassed the attic, and I bought some stuff. It's called Clear Out. I'm gonna show you a picture of it. Okay, and there it is right there. And what it is, you see, it's a canister, a little small canister. It's got a tube, and so I drill a hole in the ceiling, and then take it off. And I promise you, you don't want to be in enclosed space. And that's what that's what this stuff is for, is for people that are holed up in an enclosed space, you know. And of course, they have a hidden entrance up from the ground, from the underground entrance up through a hidden space and up in that attic. And that's what's happening. And why haven't you gone after them? Because I'm crippled and defenseless. And there is this gang of secret police out there that's waiting to cover up my murder. And so this really needs legitimate law enforcement. Okay. Here's one other idea. Okay. 2 weeks before the murder attempt, which was on January 28, 2012. Okay. I noticed somebody was trying to come in my bedroom. Okay. I had tear gas attic that week and I was concerned about retribution. Okay. And so I seen my doorknob moving. I looked over, I seen my door coming over. I went and locked that doorknob and I got this idea to put electricity on the doorknob. And there's a reason that I did that. One, I used to be an electrician, okay, too. But two, the guns I had, I didn't really trust them. You know, I hadn't fired a gun in 20 years, 25 years, or even cleaned them. And so I didn't know if they were going to work. And then the last homeowner, okay, I found the back door kicked in when I moved in here. And he died in two towns. I've got a video called Died in Two Towns. The neighbor across the street says he died in this house, but the death certificate says he died in Fort Worth. Okay. He died here. They took it in Fort Worth. What happened? But they kicked in the door. See, that was the thing, is in my mind, they're going to kick in that door and here old buddy is going to die of an overdose in two different towns, just like the last homeowner, with the help of the secret police. Okay. You know, that's what my concern was. So I get this brilliant idea to strip a wire of extension cord, cut extension cord, strip a wire off, and put the hot wire onto the doorknob and plug it in. Okay? It's in my house. I'm home alone, right? And you know, I was literally, what I was doing was building a safe room. Because, it was a year earlier that I had wrote my whole family and said, just in case something happens to me, it won't be an accident. Okay? Rosie Rodriguez got that email a few hours before she comes sneaking to my house stealing that evidence, you know? My daughter sent it to her. Anyways, that's what I did. So after the fact, okay, that night, and they wouldn't quiet. I knew they were here, but that stopped them, okay. After I was shot 2 weeks later, et cetera, all this, and I'm getting to thinking about that, and I'm thinking, I wonder if somebody grabbed that doorknob. Because if you grab that doorknob, you know, it'd probably kill you. You know, it'd probably kill you, you know. And of course, you were breaking into my house. I mean, what are you going to do? You're going to say, yeah, we were breaking into Buddy's house trying to murder him, and he put electricity on the doorknob, we got killed. You know, how could you go explain that when you're trying to break into a private home and murder somebody, right? And so I get to look in for the obituaries, and I find this guy named Matthew Don Hyman. Okay, I'm going to turn around here. And he's a young guy, okay, Matthew Don Hyman, 33 years old, passed away suddenly on January 14, 2012. That was 2 weeks before, it was 2 weeks before that was the night that it happened, okay? And so I'm reading about him, and it's going to say somewhere in here that he was a landman. Well, some of my number one suspects, actually my number one suspect for the shooter is a landman, because they're the people I've felt like in my research were tied into the prostitution oil field link. And I've always, human trafficking, right? Prostitution and landman. So he used to be a landman. Well, wow, he's a landman. And then he had went to school and he became a lawyer. And I remember when I first went and talked to my lawyer, she told me, she says, there's not a lawyer in this town that's going to help you. And I thought, that's the weirdest thing in the world. Why not? You know, I have all this evidence. I have all these pictures of the secret police. I got the police report saying the secret police are not in my home. I'm the ultimate victim. I'm, you know, 25 year in company man, moved down here. I volunteered to lead the United Way drive for my company. Had been doing that for 10 years. You know, I don't hang out in the bars. I'm a good guy. Well, I mean, what's going on here? And I'm the victim of I'm a crime victim. Now I'm a crippled crime victim. And I can't get a lawyer in the town to help me? What? You know? And that this guy was a lawyer. Huh. And I'm thinking, I wonder if, you know, he was one of them guys that was in my house and he grabbed that doorknob. And so a few weeks ago, maybe his brother, it was my nurse is who it was, or ex-nurse, that was somehow related to that family. And she writes, you know, sees my post on Facebook about this, because I ain't saying he was. I'm just threw the idea up there. Is it, you know? How did he die, you know? And was he one of the guys that was in my house trying to murder me, you know? Is this connected to this whole trafficking deal? And anyway, she writes, oh, no, it wasn't him. I was related to the family, you know? And I'm thinking, well, okay, at least I can get some information. And, you know, because if he died in the morning, I know it wasn't him. Right? I mean, that eliminated him, you know, because I know when it happened. I know when they tried to get in my room, when I put electricity on the door. So, you know, I ask her, you know, like, what happened? Oh, he died that evening. He was in his house with his family. Oh, okay, well, that didn't eliminate it, you know. Okay. Well, then I'm thinking, well, what did he die of, you know? Because if he died of cancer, you know, I mean, you know, and he was sick for 6 months, then, you know, it wasn't him, right? Oh, no, he had a weird heart condition that nobody knew about, and all of a sudden he just died that night at 33 years old. And I said, was he messing with electricity? Because electricity will stop your heart. Oh, no, no, he wasn't messing with electricity, you know. And so I post that. And next thing I know, I'm getting threatened by other landmen. One landman that used to work for my company threatened to beat me up on Facebook. I got the print screen of it, you know. And extremely rude people. And once again, here I'm the crime victim. I'm trying to solve this capital murder attempt. I'm trying to keep this gang from going and murdering more people, you know, and inform the public, you know. But, and so anyway, the idea come, well, if it was Matthew Don Hyman and his friends were here in my house, and he did die in his house, he couldn't very well go, his friends couldn't take him back and go, yeah, we were breaking in this guy's house to murder him, and that guy put electricity on the door, and now our friend's dead, right? They couldn't say that, could they? Because they go to prison, right? And so they might have had to come up with something, you know, well, you know, hey, how about you just say, well, y'all's watching TV, and he died right here of a weird heart attack. You know, I don't know. And so, but the other thing is, I bet that made his friends mad, didn't they? They probably wanted revenge and murder. And maybe that was planned 2 weeks later, and I'm shot inside my home. My phone lines are cut. And how do we know my phone lines are cut? Because I was crawling out. And that's, I didn't have any communications. They tried to kill me. They shot me from a foot away, at point blank range, directly in an artery, okay, right at the ground, ambushed me. I didn't even see it coming. And my phone lines cut. I should be dead right now. You know, I give God all the praise and glory here. Okay, so anyway, that's a possibility. That's all it is. Is it? Somebody check, you know, somebody do the research on this, you know, and maybe that was. And it might point back to the people that did try to murder me. Maybe this guy's friends, if that was it, okay? And so the other thing that I think is real important is the underground facility. I've had a half dozen people tell me that there's an underground facility within a half block of this house. One woman, I've got her documented, a print screen of it says I was telling her on Facebook. I said there's an underground facility somewhere by my house, and she says, I know, it's a half block away. Print screen, I got her name, you know, here she said it. And she's only one of a half dozen people telling me it. Recently, phone call, I need to talk to you, buddy. I met this guy, and he was telling me that there's four underground facilities. They're $1 million a piece, okay? And they cost, you know, they're 25 foot deep. And I already suspected these were connected to human trafficking, prostitution, et cetera, okay? And I know when I went to the FBI in 2012, and there, even as of today, there's some question if the FBI has a shredded evidence or destroyed evidence that I presented to them. But I remember telling Dominic, the FBI agent Dominic, I said, maybe it's an underground illegal casino brothel. And he says, maybe. He said it just like that, you know. And what was that to you? I tell you, hey, that's an underground casino brothel, you know. That's what it told me, you know. And so, you know, I think more than just the $1.5 million insurance money, house and all that, and you know, that the big payday is them underground facility. Now, I've got a video on my YouTube's Buddy Web. It's called $1 Million Underground Facility. Underground $1 Million Facility is, or something like that. You can find it and watch that. You'll hear the voice call. I mean, and then that way it's not me sitting here like I am now telling you this person said this. You can hear them tell me over the phone. You can see the print screen, okay? And so, you know, it's this type of evidence I'm getting from multiple people. So, possible motive for murder, $1 million. They don't want to give this up, you know. And even the first person that even mentioned underground facility says, warned me and says, these people won't want to give this up, okay? And now I know it means murder. And then I'm going to show you in person one of the other, and it could be something else. Maybe they murder for fun. You know, we don't know. But what we do know is that I didn't shoot myself, so somebody shot me. And we do know that there's people dressed in cop costumes in my house covering up the murder attempt that we believe are cops, okay? And they got to get identified before they murder other people, okay? We know that. That's a fact. That's what we know. That's the white. The what, but the why is the question here. And I'm going to show you one more. I had got home that day, January 28, 2012, and been having 14 months of repeated burglaries to my home. And I recognized somebody was in the living area of my home while I was gone. And I had this brilliant idea to tie wire the door shut, the spare bedroom door shut. And that way it would compartmentalize my home. It would take away any kind of back door. I'd already been told that there was a trap door here at this time. I was also told there was micro cameras. And so I had done that. And then I got shot that night. I crawled out. I was in the hospital. I was gone 10 days. And when I come back, okay, here's what I found. Okay. Let's go in here. When I come back, I had, okay, and I'm in the hallway. This is my guest bathroom right here, okay? And you turn the corner, and we're going to see a closet straight ahead, one bedroom, and then another bedroom, okay? So I tie-wired all these doors together, okay? And what I think happened here is that one of these burglars, home intruders, these criminals that have been breaking my house repeatedly, breaking into my house, got trapped in this room, inside this room. And they never expected to do that because, you know, who would think that, you know, that I would tie wire the doors, you know? And so they went in there to hide, and next thing you know, I'm tying the doors. Well, I'm on the other side over here with a gun, okay? And they've been breaking my house for 14 months, you know? And so when I get home 10 days later after the hospital, what I find is this door right here, okay? And here's the door. The hinge on the bottom down here was torn off from the wall, okay? And you know, so, you know, it was like literally torn off. Somebody had brute force torn that door off. And there was pry marks on the inside top door jamb. I painted the whole house when I moved in here, and I'll show you up here, right here, that wasn't there. I mean, it just wasn't there. That was done, you know, I believe it was done minutes after I crawled out, because I believe somebody was in here, and I'm on there on the other side with a gun. I just didn't know it at the time. And so that's possible one of their motives for murder, you know, because if you think about it, okay, here they are. They're career criminals. That's a fact. They've committed thousands and thousands of crimes and continue to commit crimes. And they think we're so smart and everything. And next thing you know, they get trapped in a bathroom and the homeowner's got a gun, you know, and a right to protect his life and his home. And so they're probably scared. And so then they got a choice, you know, well, we can call the police and turn ourselves in and say, hey, we're a low life criminal. Come arrest us and throw us in prison. Or we can call our friends and we can murder him and collect that insurance money or whatever, right? You know, and we get the house available and we'd be back in business selling children to truckers out back or whatever, right? And so there's you some motives.